Hello everyone, Ben here. I'm just going to do a quick lecture on 7 tips for digital presentations. A bit of a warning beforehand, some will be more useful for you than others. Hopefully there's some useful tips in there for everyone. I'm going to put the timestamps for each of the tips that I'm going to go through today in the YouTube player. So if you want to sort of skip ahead and see what's in there, feel free to do that and probably listen to me at double speed, you know, save your time. But Patrick asked me to do this lecture because we are rapidly approaching the final presentation for the studio, and we'll be having a large formal presentation over 2 days. And obviously it'll be a digital presentation, still with not being able to go back onto campus and with a lot of us being spread out at the moment. So it's worth thinking about how you'll be presenting from now onwards. And hopefully starting to sort of complete some of the work now, so it's not a huge rush towards the end. So with that in mind, that's the first tip, which seems rather basic, but it's very common to get caught up in Final Studios. You know, we're constantly designing and refining, doing more research, responding to tutor feedback. We need to really start planning now. It's 4 weeks away, less than 4 weeks away, for the submission date. So even if, you know, it'll be unlikely that design drawings will be done at this point, there might be a lot of your research and analyses that's done, and is always very close to being at a submission level, if it isn't already. So that should be starting to figure out where that would sit in your next presentation. And start putting together, I really like you doing draft layouts. That's something I've always loved doing when I'm working, especially at uni, I did a lot, but even now we're doing pitches for competitions. We'll tend to sketch out really roughly what's going to go in the project. And that becomes a very important tool because we can see, first of all, before we do all of the work, is it making sense? Is it communicating what we want it to? Is it responding to the brief? Patrick will give you a brief of what some expected requirements are. So obviously a lot of flexibility in that for you to sort of define your own brief, define your own question. And you might have drawings that would work very well for your project that might not necessarily be in that list of deliverables, but they're still probably very important for you to communicate the overall idea. So yeah, as a first thing, consider doing this. This image I have on the screen is more detailed than I imagine you're going to. Typically the way I will do this when I'm working at uni is I'll go into the printer rooms, and we can still go there, and I'd pull out a big failed A0 print and I'd just start sketching on the back of it. So I could put this drawing here, I could put that drawing there. We're different now, we're online. So, you know, you might pull out an Envision board if you're using Envision, or even a piece of paper or a butter paper, and sketch it out. But don't think in terms of panels now, think in terms of what's going to be shown on the screen. And so these drafts are really good, like I said, for developing a narrative, so you can sort of start to understand the flow, making sure you're not missing anything, but also lets you create a hierarchy, which I think is the first important point about this. Hopefully for all of you, you get all the work you want done, you're 100% happy with your projects, and you're not rushing at all towards the end, and you sleep, you know, 8 or 9 hours a night. That was never the case for me. I tended to have a list of drawings I wanted to get done, and I'd have to rate them and say, you know, these are the crucial ones to communicate my idea and my design. And then there are these other ones which are really nice to have, and I kind of want to get them done a lot. But they won't make or break the project without them. So, but you don't really know that until you've started to plan it out. And I've in the past spent a lot of time really slaving over drawings when, you know, they maybe got 10 seconds of attention during an actual crit. So try to be really, just by starting now, I think you can be really conscious of what's going in there. That second point on the left, consider the narrative. That's sort of what I was talking about, is do the drawings you have and the information setting flow in such a way that you can communicate it to someone who hasn't spent a year focusing on this project like you have. So the way you present information, the way you do your graphics will have a really strong impact on the way people perceive and understand your project. And then the third point, again, you guys have done a lot of studios, so this is probably a little simple, but I just know from, this is a larger studio over 3 months, there's a lot more work. You'll have to consider how you curate, what goes in and what doesn't go into the final presentation. So start to make a plan about, you know, when do you lock in a graphic style? You might already have it from developing over the last, you know, two terms, and then the first two assignments here. I've been speaking to a few people who have a general idea but haven't really locked it in. Maybe in a week you have to have that locked in, and then you might really want to have all of your research and analysis elements completely done within 2 weeks or even a week and a bit, so that they're not, you're not going back and redoing old work or refining things that you already have with you when we're focusing on that final design development, but also communication. So seems simple, but just because of the extra amount of work you've done on this assignment, I'd really encourage you all to start to make a plan about when you'll be doing it. A lot of students put that in their process journal, which was great. It's that sort of thing that helps you sort of develop a project, and it's very much like being in practice when, you know, there are deadlines for each drawing. This is something I'll talk about a little bit more in a minute, but think about your style. And that's what we're saying earlier with having a plan and getting your style right at one point. How do you want to present it? Is it a series of drawings that are photorealistic and a hand draw everything? They'll affect the time that you're going to do on it. And you've all done a range of different work over your uni career. So you'll know what you like. You've seen precedents. I'd really encourage you to talk to your tutors, talk to past tutors, current tutors, other tutors in the group, talk to students, and sort of ask them, do you think this is the best way to present my project? I kind of have these four examples on the screen. All exterior shots looking at a building, all presented in very different ways. And they take different skill sets and different levels of effort, but they kind of give a different feeling and sensation, right? So the one on the left is very warm, has a lot of texture, not a lot of detail, but it gives a sense of how the place would feel. The two in the middle are a little bit more technical. And then the one on the right-hand side is more photorealistic and more difficult, but it sort of strips it back and makes more graphic with the pink element. And they all make you feel different ways about the project. So start to have that in your mind and be conscious that you'll be designing, your presentation will be structured in such a way that people, like I said, who haven't seen your project for last year, can get a feel of it very quickly in the 15 or so minutes that you have to speak. And the visual presentation is, I think, not the most important, but a very crucial element of that. The second tip, and it sort of flows on from that last bit, is have a really consistent presentation style. A lot of people at the moment have, fantastic drawings, that are hand-drawn and sketched, and then their sections might be completely different. And that can be okay. And if that's the way you want to do it, this isn't a hard and fast rule, it's just something to consider. But like I was saying in the last slide, the way your drawings look will impact the way people perceive it, at least in the first instance. So developing that style that's going to run throughout it, that's important, not just for this assignment moving on, especially if you want to put together a body of work that's recognized. And I'll show you a few examples of that in a minute. Can control the way the audience perceives your work. Is it bright and airy, and are there people everywhere, and does it feel very crowded? Is it all done in pastel colors? That may not necessarily suit someone whose project's on the industrial history of Balmain. It might do, but there isn't a direct connection there, whereas you might opt for something in more of a grayscale or with pops of color. To show something like that. Create a visual language that works with your design narrative. So as you're planning out where these things are going, what types of drawings will help communicate that. So I wanted to quickly run you through a couple of different firms that have a very distinct style that I like. And the reason I picked these four is, one, because I think their architecture, and I apologize that they're a lot more architectural focused, although a lot of them do work in urban spaces. I do have some great landscape focused architects I was going to look at, but I thought you guys probably know all of them. So there's a chance that there might be some new people in here and some new ways of presenting. So I thought I'd show you these. So this is Dobak Block Jaggers. They're a Sydney-based firm, and this is the Bondi Surf Lifesaving Club. And so Dobak have this really soft, sketchy style a lot of the time. It's experimentation. They do, if you go on their website, there's a great connection between that those thinking drawings that are very expressive and showing form to their final projects. They do these beautiful sort of testing models, looking at different colors and ideas. And I think in isolation, if you just had one of them, I've had a student comment before, they look kind of childish. When you see them as a body of work with, you know, renders that are, you know, quite detailed, but still have that cartoonish and sort of very engaging, soft pastel colors, it creates a certain sensation. They have a tendency to really draw your eye to the thing they want you to focus on. So in all but the top left image, really, you can very much tell the thing they want you to look at. So there's the stark black background against the model. There's the white background all around the watercolor. The image in the two rendered images, one which is more detailed, both gray out the surrounding buildings and just sort of treat their building as a highlight. And you can see that in both, they've really focused on the urban space around where they've given detail. They put people in, they put grass, they put water, and they're focused on their building, but the rest sort of bleeds away. So whether that's appropriate for you, I'm not sure, but it's a very simple and elegant way to present. The next person I want to talk about was Mary Duggan. It's a bit of a blurry photo, I apologize, but it's a very cool firm in England, working out of the UK. And I love Mary's work, but one of the things I'm really in love with is her website and the way they choose to present and represent their work. It's incredibly textural. I'll show you the website in a moment, and every project starts with a picture of a model, and you can see these beautiful testing models looking at form, looking at roughness, looking at color, looking at the gradation of things. That same textural study shows up in the render, which again is equally soft and pastel like, very inviting. Obviously it feels very different to the model pictures, but I think it's a really great consistency amongst their work. Even in the drawings, the drawing down the bottom, you know, quite simple, just a master plan, it's almost figure ground style plan, but understated, pared back, picks up on those pastel colors. And so as a body of work, you can really read it as, you know, a single hand or a single idea. They're all different projects, but the approach you can read as a single idea. And it feels very inviting and warm. So this might be a style you want to look at for yourself. Going in a completely different direction, Bjark Ingels Group, all of you know Big. I put them in because, yeah, they're very different to the last two I've shown. They focus on like super graphics, so really intense graphical images. There's the comic book that Bjark Ingels wrote there, so very strong graphics, high contrast images, futuristic forms, pops of color that really pull you in, whereas both of the other two we'd already looked at were much more subtle and pastel and kind of made your eyes sort of darted around the image and took it in. Here, on the images on the right-hand side, your eyes pulled towards the green and pulled towards the pink. So it's a very energetic way of presenting. And that could be really important for some of you, especially the way they do diagrams to show how the ideas developed. That's something I'll talk about using Big's work in a little bit. And the final one I want to look at for this tip is Florissant Pratt's. So that's Ricardo and Eva down the bottom there. But you can see some of their work, very, very experimental and textural, great amounts of detail that go into all of the elements. And if you haven't, I specifically want to include Flores and Prats because I know a lot of people hadn't heard of them. And so I really want to encourage you, if you've got some time, to check them out. I know we're getting busy. Completely different style. Everything they do is by hand. All their models are made by hand. All their drawings are done by hand. Very warm, very technical, very detailed. So there's a really, it's a very different style to everything we've seen so far. But they communicate their intent really, really beautifully. And, you know, this, you have to, there's a lot of work in doing this sort of style, so it doesn't suit everyone. But I included this, again, to show you them. But also I was asked last week by someone if it's okay to draw by hand. And I think so. I think it can be done beautifully. You know, just that we can rely too much on the computer. So if you feel comfortable drawing, that's the way you want to present. As long as you think it makes sense and you can do all of the work, because drawing by hand typically takes longer, then I am totally fine with that. But you should speak with your tutor. But yeah, there is definitely a role still for these hand skills and the communication of design. One thing I mentioned was that another reason I picked these projects was those architects to show you. Those are really great websites. And so I think if you're interested in how those, if you liked any of those styles, I would jump on their websites and you can flick through. So you see Bjark Ingels has this fantastic website where it shows you all of the sort of research and analysis and then some of the design moves, really strong graphics, always overlaid, sort of flicking from one to the next. And then he'll, you know, after all these decisions, start to get more detail, more articulation, the zoom in, and then you start to get the detailed rendered shots. You can go through all of them. There's a great amount of work on their website, very graphical again, and you can click through and sort of look at all of them. Really, really great way of presenting, particularly digitally. So a lot of these ways, the way it's presented on this website, it's very similar to how they present it in lectures. The next one, very different style of websites. It's Mary Duggan's website. Like I said, all beautiful model and artifact images at the start as you come in. So if I sort of just pick on this one, you can come in and you see this really soft, beautiful modeling style photographed on an eye level, which I think is beautiful. This is a live project, so it's ongoing. So these are more tests as we go through. You can go in and look at other different types of projects, but a really beautiful soft pastel-y color. So that might be something you want to look at. Derbach Block Jaggers, if you go into their website, they have a really great selection of work on there. I might just pick some really beautiful, you know, rough sort of organic sketches, but there's that same language, the same sort of design language, the same way of representing, you know, strong visual thing blacked out. It's something Patrick was talking about, always contextualizing where it is, you know. And then this image is great because we look at the bright building, we understand that there's skyscrapers around it, but our eye is drawn then to the next most detailed thing. It's a hierarchy to this drawing. We're drawn there and all of a sudden we know what city we're in, we know where it is, we can figure out the orientation. So a really interesting way of presenting. They do lots of these little tests, really great sketches. Even they do a mix of hand drawing, computer drawing, but it's the same language to them. So there's a really good consistency. And by far the coolest website, and I won't have time to show all of it, but I really, if you take nothing else away from this, go check out the Flores and Prats website. It starts with a tour. It's all filmed in stop motion, the entire website. So their doorman lets you in, you go up the stairs, you know, you buzz in or you take the elevator. Really, really interesting the way they do it. So much work and curation, and this detail of how they set up the website. As you'll see later when I show something else that they've done, it defines their style. It defines the way they think about their work, the way they present their work. It's really, really beautiful. So you can ring the doorbell and come into the office. It's a bit long, so I'll skip ahead. You eventually end up in their studio. So you can pick whichever room you want to walk into. We're going to walk into this room, for instance. It takes you through. See all of the working models, everything in there as you flicker around. And I won't spend too much time on it, but this is a way I can waste an afternoon sometimes on this website. But then you click on a project and it does these really beautiful hand-drawn graphics, again, coming in stop motion, sort of overlaid. I just skip ahead a little bit. Detailed drawings, cuts between details and photographs. So they start to, we're talking about narrative. They start to tell a story through the way they present their projects. You saw the detail and now you see the landscaping and the articulation of the forecourt. You see the footage of how it is now. So you can overlay all of these things, and Flores and Pratt does this better than any firm I know. I fell in love with their models, and if you like model making, Flores and Pratt is the firm to look at, I think. They do these beautiful technical models, but they're all about studying and looking into the space. We'll talk more about that a bit later. The final website I want to talk about really quickly, we won't look into it too much, is Kuzarch. Kuzarch is a great website if you want to look at how other recently graduated or sort of final year students presenting their work across the world, particularly Europe and in America. But there are some really great projects from all around the place. And it's really interesting because you know, it shows you all these different styles of presentation. You can click through and look at them. But as you read in, go into here, it has excellent interviews with the people who produce the work. So they, you know, they break them out into these topics of the activated city, and people respond to that brief. Very different presentation styles. Some are very graphic, some are more photo-based, some are even essay-based and narrative-based. But as you click into them, and you can kind of pick the ones you like, it lets you read about the intent of the mostly students, but again, some recent graduates, and why they chose to show it this way, why they thought this was the appropriate way to respond, both graphically and as a brief. So really, really nice as a way to, but I like it as a way of getting me to think more about the way I present. There are some excellent political sort of statements in here. I just noticed the council rent thing there. That comes up a lot, and they're always very interesting briefs. Not always borne out in reality, but a lot of really good information. So I'd encourage you to check out Kuzarch if you're interested in different ways of presenting or looking for it. I know we're, again, only 4 weeks out, so you don't want to totally reinvent the wheel. But you might be looking for a new way to present something on this scale if you haven't done that before, or to present a certain type of, you know, idea or message that you hadn't had tried to do before. So really, really good website. There's obviously always Pinterest, things like that as well. I'm going to share a few of my Pinterest boards this week, just for anyone who wants some, you know, inspiration for different ways to go. But, you know, Pinterest can be hit and miss. Kuzarch is generally always very good. Point three. Is we really need to consider your medium. And by that, I mean the medium through which we're presenting. So it's a completely digital presentation. You'll be presenting to your tutors, as well as a range of guests. And I think that idea, that range of guests, is very important. So we won't be together with the guests, I don't think. They'll be in different places. Patrick mentioned most of them will be from Sydney, but some won't be. But so we'll all be sort of tuning in to your presentation. which means the way you would typically present with a big panel for your final project no longer necessarily applies. And that there's just some changes you have to make in the way you do that. One really big thing I think you need to be quite aware of is that you can't control the way someone is viewing it the way you put it in person. In person, you know, they sit, you put the big panels up and they kind of sit around it, and there's not a lot of variation in how the critics or your peers get to see the work. Digitally, there's a lot of variation because people can have different size screens. Some people might be tuning in on, you know, smaller iPads, God forbid, maybe on their phones. Other people are going to be looking at it on a huge 40-inch plus monitor. But you can't control that. So you need to really be cautious that your presentation is legible and engaging the whole way through. Part of that is not overloading what goes on the screen. And the other part is thinking about how you use this digital medium as an asset for you. So showing this project, this is a typical graduation project, actually a great graduation project by Allison, I think in 2016, also on the same site that you guys are working on now. So maybe some ideas, you can go Google it after and steal some ideas if you haven't already looked at this. Really great projects, excellent panels, fantastic to look at all the information, all the thinking. I believe she won a medal for this, but a fantastic project. But I'm looking at it on a very big screen right now, 44 inches or something. And the text is too small to read. I can barely make out the diagrams. I can't read any of the information on the bottom. So there's, in this way of presenting in huge panel formats it's sort of not ideal. I know you guys all know that, but I just want to kind of bring it home. This is a fantastic project, but the presentation here doesn't work the way we're presenting. So instead, I want to talk to you about going back to Bjarke Ingels, Big's work. They did a project in Canada, this skyscraper on the right there. And I want to show you, I'm just going to quickly talk through how they're presenting their work. And I just think the way they do this is an excellent series of design moves. So we have the site. This is a great way of introducing the site, an aerial shot, really strong super graphic highlighting where it is. The different site constraints will come in a second, but we're just seeing the site. Then we snap away from the photorealistic. And the reason for that is it's a lot more dominant than cutting straight to the digital model. Digital model, we can strip everything back. There's less detail. It's just the form. And now all of the overlays get there, the heroes. There's a hierarchy to what we're seeing. So really, really clever. Go to the next one. And what I really like, and I think what works so well digitally, is that the background doesn't move. You know, there's no shifts. We don't have to go where, if it's on a panel, we've got to kind of trace it with our eyes to make sure nothing's moving. As you flick through, you know, backwards and forwards through these graphics, the information that's on there becomes very clear. You can see the changes, and you can speak to the analysis you've done. You know, you might have some text and, you know, some photos that represent what you're talking about. This might be an underground gutter or drain, for instance. You can put that information there, but it lets you speak to this. It makes it very, very clear. You know, get to see this huge extrusion. So this isn't just a 2D way of doing it, you can work in 2D and 3D. As an aside, this project was all about, they only had that very small triangular form to work in, but they wanted to get more apartments. So they thought they would go up in a triangular form and twist and bring a square up there, and you get this really funky looking skyscraper. And you know, it looks cool, but it was justified through those early graphics. And you can go and listen to some lectures on this. It's quite interesting the way they describe it. But really, really clear. You can understand all the moves. And there's hours and hours of research and analysis in each one of these steps. You know, even here to identify, this is looking at extra opportunities around the set. There's all this work in there, but you can distill it down very simply to someone who's seeing this for the first time. Said it before, sound like a bit of a broken record. But you've spent a year working on this, or close to a year. Some people will see this for the first time. So the more you can help them come along with you and understand your process, the better. And so, you know, this is the final result, a really wacky thin skyscraper that twists and cantilevers. But it doesn't seem, you know, obnoxious, perhaps, because the steps and the reasoning were shown really well. So that's just a very quick way I want you to think about, you know, there's so many different ways to talk with your tutors. You know, send me a message if you want. There are really great ways to show some information digitally. And I think use it to its advantage. You know, with a digital medium, you can present with different types of media. You can also, you know, have those flick throughs. You can go back and forth. And the most important thing, which I think if I come back to here for me, is that you control what people are looking at. When there's a panel, a large panel like this one here, it's very hard to control. You can point to them, you can talk into it, but the critiquer might be looking up and looking at the materials and side elements on the bottom right-hand side. You know, it just might catch their eye. You have full control here, so you get to take them on the process. I think you should use that very clearly. It's an asset. There are a lot of, I know, downsides to presenting online, but this is a really great upside to it, that you get to curate and control how people see your work. So just be really cautious of that and try to think, that's why you're doing those plannings from the earlier steps. And what am I showing? Is it going to communicate what I want it to? Okay, point number four, and hopefully the quickest point, is if you're making models, and hopefully everyone will be making models for testing as we go, but also for presenting and communicating your design, photograph them with care. This seems like sort of a simple point, but the amount of dirty laundry or coffee cups you see in the back of model photos is a lot. It's quite immense. So be really deliberate in the same way I want you to think about being deliberate in the way your presentation style will work, is how you photograph these models and how you present them to us. Being online gives you a really unique opportunity to curate the way we see the model. So we can't see it in the Red Center, obviously. We get to see it the way you present it to us. So in that sense, I think it's really important to photograph it well. There's a diagram at the top that has some ideas about different ways of lighting it. I take a lot of model photos and I don't really do anything that intense. I actually prefer to photograph with natural light so I can get sort of real sun, and then to have a light right next to me just to kind of even out the light. And then a white background. And even if you just use natural light or phone light, the most important thing I think is a white background. You know, not sort of seeing the back of the house. You really don't want anything that's going to detract the way you think, the way the viewers perceive those models. You want them to be totally focused on that. A good example is in this bottom right-hand image. You know, it's meant to be showing that screen, but all I can look at is that awful carpet. Apologies to anyone who has that carpet. But, you know, so instead, if you create a little screen like this, and it can be as simple as taping a bit of A3 or A2 paper to a wall, you know, it can be quite rough. If you do that, though, you get a really crisp background. And that means if you're going to photograph your model without, you know, and then just present it as sort of an artifact, just this object that you've made or this scene you've made against a white background, it'll look beautiful. But it also helps then for if you do want to edit your model later, which is something I'll be talking about in a minute, is you can crop it a lot more easily. There's a lot more contrast. That only applies though if you consider the color of your model and the color of the background. So if you're making a fully white model, you might want to do a black background. So that way you get that contrast, which is better, again, better for editing or even just better to read it as. And so just to hammer on that point really quickly is we can't pick up the model. In studio, normally one of my favorite things to do in presentation is the first thing I do is pick up a model off the table and start to look at it as they're talking, which is maybe a bit disruptive. But it's really nice to sort of, you can kind of look ahead. Often, you know, presentations will start looking at analysis or different sort of earlier design moves. And I like to kind of pick up the model and pass it around with the other tutors. So we can't do that anymore. We can only see the model the way you're presenting it to us. So you get to curate the experience, which again is one of those other, I think, advantages presenting online. In person, you can't really control where we look or how we do it. Here, you know, it's all curated by you. So with that in mind, I think it's much more like a theater set than an actual model, because you don't need to make the back if you're not planning on showing it. You know, if I can pick up a model in person, if the back's all covered in glue and it's not, you know, you've been painting it, it's still not dry, you know, it kind of looks pretty crappy. But as it's photographed, we have no idea about that. So that again comes back to that planning. Don't make half a model that you're not going to show in a photo. Okay. Point five, again, thinking about models, if you're making good models, consider, because of this opportunity to curate them, is using the models to set the scene. You know, often when we take photos of models or present them, we kind of treat it as a bird's eye view looking down. And a big focus of this studio has been, Patrick introduced this idea of looking at versus being in. And that was probably something I noticed in the last summit that was lacking a little bit across the board. Some people did it very well, and I think everyone's starting to think about it. I think there's a room for growth in this assignment. And I think models might be an interesting way to do it if you're so inclined. And I won't talk too much about this, but models are the thing I love making, sort of more than drawing, more than computers. I love making things with my hands. So I've always done some research and thinking about models. And you guys should all know this, Jørn Utzon, the architect of the Sydney Opera House. And there's a lot of famous models for the Sydney Opera House. There's the orange model. There's those rings there, which are more of an experimental model, but they're really all about presenting. And there's this really interesting article, which I'll show you in a second, that talks about the way formerly designers and architects, was always you know, a white man typically, back in this day, except for some notable exceptions, and they were always photographed with their model sort of as an artifact, an object. So that's something that stuck with me is, you know, I like to use the model for testing. So I make a lot of rough sketch models, and I also like to use it for showing, but sort of communicating internally. And from a similar era as Ray Charles Eames, and I just love this, that their approach was very different to that. You know, they have photographed their models too, but they have this approach of looking into the model. So you see there, they're setting up this shot. So they've built, you know, all the people, they've built, this is, I think, an exhibition they've made, even in the right-hand corner, the bottom right-hand corner, looking into the house they've designed for themselves, sort of experience what it's like to be in there. And this works at different scales. And I know these are very much small residential ideas at the moment. I'm going to show in a second away. I think you could do it on a larger urban scale. But think about this as a way that you could potentially show what it's like to be in there with the same model. You know, models take a lot of time to make. So if you're going to do it and do it well, make sure you photograph it well. Make sure you look for every opportunity to use it. And so this is a beautiful model that I don't know how it appears to you guys. But whenever I look at this, my eyes at first think it's real, and then they think it's a render. And then only then, only because I know now, and only after I really look at it, can I see that it's a model. You know, it's all made out of balsa wood through here, corrugated cardboard, just some plaster packed into there, you know, just bits of sheet, but really, really effective. And because of the way they've augmented it with the rendering and in Photoshop, I think it really, really is a great tool for communicating design, especially if you might not know how to model curtains. Curtains are a relatively hard thing to model if you can't use a program like 3ds Max. So making them, ripping a bit of cloth and folding it up is not particularly hard, a bit time consuming, but so you might have elements in your model that you want to show, but you don't know how to do digitally. And you know, you could work on that, or a model could be a really great option. And I love this one because it shows activity, people moving through the model, but it also shows a sense of time. And a sense of time, I think, is really important to what we're doing in our studio, the garden growing in the center. So there's those three views on top, looking at the planting, the activity of it happening there. So we see this community developing. This is for a peace pavilion, actually mentioned us by Alejandro Salatariga and Dakia Benkaran. I'm sure I said them wrong. But yeah, those three images at the top, you can see the growth, which a lot of you are looking at time and phytoremediation. You know, you can show the sort of the role and how planting first occurs, how it develops over time, all through the same photograph sort of model, which is great. You don't have to do multiple renders, you already have the photograph. So I think this is a really interesting way of presenting. And I'd encourage you, if you're sort of interested in making models, is to think about, you know, can it be more than just a bird's eye view looking at it? And it won't suit everyone's project, but if it does suit yours, it could be a really great way to show it. With that in mind, I wanted to quickly show you a sort of sped up version of the way I approached that. This is an old model I was working on for an art gallery. It's just a staircase around the outside. So I really roughly photographed it, not following all of my rules. We'll talk about that a bit later. And started to crop it out, which was quite easy, because even though it was sort of not the best photograph, it's really good contrast, even though right at the back. And so I was just kind of making up a project as I went along. And I decided that I would do a sort of combination of historical image looking at the wharfs, and I'd sort of show the front of the image would be a current day, and then the back would be historical. And so I put the background image in and I used that, and then started to distort and skew the model so that I could actually make it edit it. You want to make sure your images line up in perspective. And you can see here I'm bringing in an image from Glebe Island Bridge. And that's because I wanted the water to match. A few people had water that looked like it was coming from Barbados. It's beautiful, but doesn't represent Sydney Harbour. So try to be really careful when you're making these images, whether it's a model or just a render. Just a Photoshop tip for everyone. When you're doing this sort of stuff, you're editing background images, always use a layer mask. Don't just delete the image, because you want to be able to go up and touch it up. You can see here, it's a bit painful to watch in real time, but it's not too bad, hopefully. I'm sort of going in and tidying up those edges so we don't have like a really harsh, strong line coming through. And if I'd already deleted the image around it, then I wouldn't be able to do that. But using a layer mask, I can go in and touch up edges. And that's really important, because I'm really quickly and crudely doing this at the moment. And you want to give yourself that opportunity to come through. So lots of little things. You can start to play around with like perspective as well. So you let the water come onto the step with a little bit more there, just so it's not so even and looks so fake. Like I said, the model was really rough. It's sort of a sketch model I was making. So I'm using the healing tool now to go through and actually just tidy up some edges. In some places I decide I'm happy to leave it rough. There, it's just sort of going back on it. But in other places, you know, tidying them up, getting rid of different scars and things like that. But a huge issue for me with this project, again, it's more of an example. And because it's of the way I end up treating it, the marks on it aren't a huge issue. Start to think about, you know, depth and hierarchy of color. So I thought the water was a little dark here, so I did it as a hard light overlay, so it picks up some of the grays from underneath. So I feel like it starts to match tonally a little bit better. I grabbed some mangroves. Mangroves seem very trendy on the side at the moment. So I just, you know, did a color range, got rid of all of those. So the mangroves were good to sort of set the scene, but they're also really good because the perspective wasn't working particularly well on both corners of this image. So I used the trees as a way of hiding it. And sometimes and you'll see in a second, I use people to hide different things on the model, objects, different graphics. So it can be all hard to perfectly align your model with a photograph. So this is one way of doing it, aligning it as best you can and then hiding it a little bit. See there, I'm starting to take some people from non-Scandinavia. And because I have a bad Photoshop technique, I'm just copying them over. You can save them you probably have great collections of people that you can use. One thing to keep in mind with these, when you're picking people, is make sure they're appropriate for the site. And that I mean, is not some guy jumping in the water like I've got there and then someone right next to them in a full ski coat. And those seem obvious, but the things you kind of miss when you're starting to lay this stuff out. Again, this guy was really good at hiding sort of a bum edge, and he also, I think, was a great way of directing the eye past. Started to play around a little bit with layering, because obviously the model's just in front of everything at the moment. I was a bit worried it was sort of too obvious that there were just sort of different layers in Photoshop. So I wanted to create an extra bit of mangrove that sort of hung over. That's a really small thing when you're doing it deliberately. You might do it in other places or more dramatically. But think about that. It's this little things that can sort of pull the viewer out of it. And then, you know, I'd sort of got the scene set up somewhat like what I liked. I thought I'd play around with style. So I thought I'd put like a really heavy concrete texture over the back and put it as a diffuse layer beyond. And that sort of started to play around with more photorealism in the front and more of a graphic style in the back. I then thought the cardboard looked too artificial next to some of the materials that were going on. So I put a really soft light diffuse of the concrete over the cardboard, did a few light little touch-ups, sort of playing with putting some extra shadow in, getting rid of different areas that are overhanging, cropping it to whatever size works. I personally don't like doing square images, but just sort of throwing this together really quickly. Another thing to think about is, you know, what are your aspect ratios when you're presenting? Are you consistently all doing the same size images? Have they changed? When I am doing shadows, little thing, I always have a few different opacity layers and sort of play around with heavier and lighter shadow. Not that this is the best way to do it, probably in reality put a drop shadow for each of them. This is, again, just really quick way to go about showing a way of doing it. That video shows sort of the process to go from this really basic, you know, quite roughly photographed. I wrote that you should spend a lot of time with a white background, and I kind of deliberately picked a rougher shot and didn't do the paper right and had the black section on the left-hand side, just to show that it can be really basic and be transformed. And as I've said, you know, there's nothing particularly special about the image that I made, but it is a really good way to use the model as a tool to show something. You know, I spent maybe 20 minutes on this whilst trying to come up with some design on the fly, or where it might be located, and finding some of those resources. You can spend a lot more time and focus on it and really make sure it works for you. But as a way of communicating how that space has worked, on the model on the left-hand side that isn't edited, really doesn't tell us that much about how we anticipate the space will be used. It tells us a little bit about the form, but we don't get much more than that. Whereas on the right-hand side, we can get some narratives looking back at the industrial nature. We get an idea of the context, the planning of the mangroves, and then we're also getting a sense of how we think it might be used. So I think it can be a really great tool if it's something you're interested in. So point number six, and we're getting closer to the end, is, you know, that last point was looking at how you transform a model into a still image. I think models and presentations in digitally in general are really good at showing movement, which in turn shows activity and life. And so I'm going to show you a few ways of augmenting that same model to show some movement. And then I'm also going to show you a great example of how Floris and Pratz uses one of their models to show movement and to show a narrative and sort of a bigger story than just the model. So those are things we'll be looking at for this point. But think about what you can do that works for your assignment digitally. If your research is all about sound, can you play a sound over an image, if that's important? I know I have some students who are looking at this, sort of positive and negative sounds on the site. But it maybe doesn't convey as well in an image as it does when you're just looking at when you're looking at the image and then you hear the sounds as well. So think about the role, the information you're trying to communicate and the role that the digital media can play in that. You know, they can create videos, GIFs, you know, different sound studies, collages, there's a whole bunch of things. I purposely haven't touched on new video rendering. So Figure, if you don't know how to do it now, you probably don't want to learn in 4 weeks. If anyone's interested in learning any of them, 3ds Max, Lumion, Twinmotion, and Once a Hand, let me know. Or Maya, I guess. But you know, those are sort of big, heavy programs that can take a while to learn. All of the things we're going to look at here are quite quick and easy to do. Image just did. I might introduce this idea of just in that one image from Stila, what if you want to introduce some movement? I'm going to do that by bringing it into Premiere Pro, essentially by making a green screen. So I deleted the background and put in a big green background, bright green. Can kind of be any color, but green works really well. And then in Premiere Pro, I added another video underneath that's a time lapse of the site. And the idea is I'm going to extend out the length of my still image to match the length of the video. I'm going to use an effect called Ultra Key. So if you click, type in Ultra Key and effects, you can select the eyedropper, click the green, and it'll essentially make whatever color you pick with the Ultra Key disappear. So it's a way of making sort of really quick and crude green screens. I had to do a bit of scaling with the images. If I was more deliberate or when I actually got footage from the site, I probably could have got the perspective to line up. But as it was, I decided I'd quickly try to just get something to work with that. You can see it's a bit naff, you know, the people are sort of just hovering in the air while the day moves. I think in reality, if I was going to do this one again, I probably would not have the people there. I might just introduce some lights that are going to change on the pool so I can show the way, you know, the lighting conditions might change on the set. That was just to show you. And I thought also, you know, what a lot of things we're looking at are tidal edges. So I thought it might be kind of fun. So here I play around with the effects for a little bit for the sequence size. If you don't know how to use Premiere Pro, I should say, it's actually quite easy, all this stuff. And if you want to, you can either slow this video down and follow it along, or I'm happy to walk anyone through it if this is something you're interested in doing. But essentially here, I'm just taking some stock footage I found of a coastal condition and doing a pretty naff little insert of that tidal edge. And it just came to mind because I know that a lot of people are looking at that edge zone and looking at that change. And, you know, you could either find found footage or now a lot of people can now go to the site. Maybe capture it yourself, ask someone else to. I'm happy to capture footage if anyone needs it. So it's just, you know, as you can see, this is not a, you know, particularly profound way to make a video to show movement. But I thought it was a fun way just to think about the potential of movement in videos. So there's, you know, and so really we just get to tell a story about water flowing in that space. People don't match as well as sort of edits that can be done to improve it, but as an idea that can be communicated really quickly, something that could definitely be developed, I think it might be a good tool for everyone. The last thing I want to show you in this section is this project I mentioned at the start by Floris Pratt, Sala Beckett, and this is one of my favorite ways I've ever seen a model used, or a model in conjunction with other media. And obviously this is looking at a building, but I think the same lessons and approach could have definitely be used for a large urban site. So it shows movement, it shows occupation. And as you just saw, it sort of links between capturing the model, showing real footage from the site, it'll integrate stills as well. Has a great soundtrack playing over the top of it, which I'll let play for a second now so you kind of take that in. So this is obviously very elaborate, and you might not opt to do something this elaborate for yours, but thinking about the option of using the model not only for showing the form, but also for showing movement. A lot of you have talked about how you guide people through those set-ted strategies, how people move through a space. So if you have, you know, some sort of figure or that moves through it, and then do you cut to either an image or a video that shows what that condition is like? And I know this is very elaborate. Again, there's no requirement to do anything like this. I just wanted to show you, to me, one of the most interesting ways I've ever seen a model used to really give a whole sense of the building, including experience. So hopefully there was some interesting stuff that you can take away from Sala Beckett, and that, you know, it's something you can, if not, even if you don't apply it to this project, just to keep in mind, even for the future, that, you know, we don't have to stick to a single type of media when we're presenting. Okay, the final point. This will be your last studio. Make sure the work reflects the effort you've put in over the last 4 years. It probably sounds a bit daunting for anyone still listening to the last point. But, you know, make sure it reflects the effort you put in. And that comes back to that first point of making a plan and thinking about what's going to go into it. Often students are very caught up in marks. I don't really remember what marks I got for studio. It wasn't that big a deal in the end. There are bits of work that I'm really proud of, and that's what I remember. And so I just really encourage you, you know, to really start to think about what you want to deliver for in a month's time. You know, studio is so fun, and I know it's stressful now, but you miss it once you're gone, that this process of really dissecting work and thinking about it and being able to develop a really unique response. You don't always get that you don't get that all the time in practice. I just really want to encourage you to do that. Most importantly, have fun with it. If you have any questions about digital presentation, model making, rendering, anything like that, please let me know. But these are just a few tips. I'd really like you to start thinking about what you want to get out of this and how you want to present it. So thanks very much for listening, everyone. And I hope you get drawing or model making or rendering or something.